This episode of Real Science is brought to you by CuriosityStream. Watch thousands of documentaries for free for 31 days at curiositystream.com/realscience. It's been all over the news lately. There have been a record-breaking number of fires ravaging the Brazilian Amazon rainforest this year. Man-made fires, intentionally set to clear land for agriculture, which then spread uncontrollably. The National Institute for Space Research says it has detected more than 74,000 fires between January and August. In comparison, there were fewer than 40,000 for the same period in 2018. It is shocking to see it happening to a place many of us consider to be a pristine, lush expanse. And most of us, looking on from thousands of miles away, from behind our computer screens, feel helpless. Members of the G7 summit pledged $22 million to help fight the fires. And over the past decade, Norway has donated $1.2 billion to help conserve the Amazon, and Germany has contributed $68 million. However, they've both stopped their contributions because of doubts over Brazil's efforts to reduce deforestation. Despite money pouring in over many years to try to battle the problem, international campaigns, summits, and boycotts, it just isn't working. The recent fires are just a symptom of an ongoing problem of unregulated and out-of-control clearing for agriculture. Across the world, in South America, Africa, and Asia, the world's rainforests are being lost at a rapid pace. If current deforestation levels proceed, the world's rainforests may completely vanish in as little as 100 years. And there is so much to lose. The diversity of plants and animals in the world's rainforests is staggering, especially in person. Seeing mist rise above the canopy at sunrise while hearing gibbon calls from miles away, trekking through the forest at night and seeing alien-like insects, dodging snakes wrapped around branches, colorful, ridiculous birds, the amount of amazing creatures there is seemingly endless, and the value that they have to the world is impossible to quantify. And so, with all the terrible news stories we hear, it's easy to feel like there is no hope. To see any animals losing their habitat is heartbreaking. However, despite the headlines, all hope is not lost. There are things that can be done, and people who are doing everything in their power to ensure the rainforests survive the recent onslaught of destruction. To understand what is being done and how, let's focus on one of the most endangered ecosystems in the world, the rainforests of Malaysia and Indonesia, and in particular Borneo, home to recognizable species such as orangutans and pygmy elephants. Borneo's natural forests continue to be destroyed at a rapid pace. Between 1985 and 2005, Borneo lost an average of 850,000 hectares of forest every year. If this trend continues, forest cover will drop to less than a third in coming years. And all that deforestation has been devastating for wildlife. Nearly 150,000 critically endangered Bornean orangutans died between 1999 and 2015, and there are less than 1,500 surviving Borneo pygmy elephants. 10 to 15% of the world's unique plant and animal species live in this area, and they are all at risk of being wiped out entirely. And this is not to mention the importance of the forest in its carbon storing abilities, and how devastating clearing it will be in the battle against climate change. It's easy to point out why deforestation is bad for biodiversity, and no one wants the orangutans to die. So why is it happening? The answer to this question varies from region to region and from year to year. In Brazil, cattle ranching is the leading cause. In the DRC, it's largely due to unregulated or illegal logging for timber. And in Borneo and the rest of Indonesia and Malaysia, the forests are currently being cleared to make room for the most in-demand plant oil in the world, palm oil. This huge demand for palm oil can be traced back to the 1980s, when the world learned the dangers of trans fats. Food producers scrambled to find a suitable alternative, something cheap, with similar properties to trans fats, but less damaging to human health. The substance that ticked these three boxes was, you guessed it, palm oil. Then, in the last few decades, environmentalists ironically pushed for an increase in biodiesel production to try to stop the release of carbon from fossil fuels, not foreseeing the contradiction in their thinking. In the US, a law mandating that biofuels be incorporated into diesel promised to stop the release of 4.5 billion tons of carbon over 3 decades. Biodiesel production in the US jumped from 250 million gallons in 2006 to more than 1.5 billion gallons in 2016. Like many well-intentioned plans, this one did the exact opposite of what it was supposed to, and helped lead to the ongoing decimation of one of the world's biggest carbon sinks. By the 21st century, the palm oil boom was in full swing, and thousands of square miles of lowland forests across Borneo were planted with oil palms. Today, Indonesia and Malaysia supply 85% of the world's palm oil. And whether we realize it or not, Palm oil is in everything. Pizza dough, lipstick, ice cream, laundry detergent, soap, chocolate, instant noodles, fuel. It's an extremely cheap and versatile product, and it's nearly impossible to avoid in modern life. Globally, we each consume an average of 8 kilograms of palm oil a year. When you're in Borneo, you can drive for hours and hours and hours and see nothing but palm trees. And much of the forest you can see is under severe pressure, with animals being forced into smaller and smaller habitats. Trucks carrying the palm kernels and trucks lugging out massive, ancient trees zigzag across the landscape. This leads to the hardest question of it all. What can be done about it? There's been a recent push to boycott palm oil products, like the grocery chain Iceland is doing as explained in their controversial viral ad. This kind of stuff feels nice and is easy for people to support. However, Europe and the US account for less than 14% of global palm oil demand, so boycotts coming from these parts of the world are unfortunately not enough. Half of global demand comes from Asia, where within many of the developing economies, product price is what matters. And with palm oil accounting for 13.7% of Malaysia's gross national income and existing as Indonesia's top export, outright banning its cultivation is just not going to happen. The way to actually save the rainforest is, unfortunately, way more complicated. To save the rainforest, we have to understand the rainforest. We have to understand how it actually reacts to deforestation and degradation. Obviously, when an entire forest is slashed and burned and logged, that ecosystem is lost. But what about the surrounding forests? Are they impacted by the adjacent damage? Are any animals able to relocate? And if so, what kinds? How many? What about partially degraded forests, or young forests that are being restored? Can they support wildlife? Can some animals actually even live within the palm oil plantations? Are wildlife corridors along rivers enough to promote the movement of animals across a plantation landscape? How much forest can we actually lose before the damage is irreversible? These are the questions that need to be answered to ensure the future of the Southeast Asian rainforest, and in fact, any threatened forest in the world. One group working on finding the answers to these questions is a group of scientists nestled deep in the heart of Malaysian Borneo at the SAFE project site. SAFE stands for the Stability of Altered Forest Ecosystems, and their goal is to research biodiversity and ecosystem function change as forests are modified by human activities, and to learn whether preserving sections of forests within degraded landscapes can protect biodiversity, and how much protection is needed to be effective. The entire SAFE project experimental site has an area of 72 square kilometers, which is spread over existing palm oil plantations and untouched rainforest, much of which is slated to soon be converted into palm oil plantations. The site also contains a large virgin jungle reserve of 22 square kilometers, which will remain protected throughout the process. Within the total SAFE project area, the owners of the palm oil plantation have agreed to allow an additional 8 square kilometers of land to be set aside as forest fragments. These will be the experimental forest fragments that the scientists can study. In addition to this, Malaysian law prohibits the clearance of forest on steep slopes and along rivers, accounting for another approximately 5 square kilometers. With this arrangement, the scientists will be able to study the effect of logging before, during, and after such forest conversion, and can also study the effects of forest corridors and reserves within damaged forest. This type of experimental design is extremely valuable and extremely rare. It is not often that scientists get to work with the cooperation of the very people who are doing the damage that is being studied, and get to choose where their experimental sites are. In most cases, ecological research is carried out observationally, after the fact, which does not produce as powerful of results as an experiment like this will. The overall goal of the SAFE project is to determine the minimum critical size forest fragments can be before they fail to operate as functional tropical ecosystems. They are gathering data on animal populations, soil composition, plant populations, hydrology, insect behavior, seed dispersal, everything that a healthy tropical ecosystem needs, and seeing how that changes in different levels of forest destruction. And with this information, the ultimate goal is to find out the best way to sustainably farm palm oil, to find a compromise between agriculture and conservation. And while this experiment is set to go on for many years to come, and the full results won't be known until then, there are already hundreds of papers pouring out of this research site, and some of the results already have big implications. One study, for example, found that riparian reserves, the strips of forest that are protected along the lengths of rivers, that have over 40 meters of natural vegetation on each bank, supported similar bird diversity to the control habitats found in continuous protected forest. However, to support equivalent numbers of birds of conservation concern, reserves would need to be at least 100 meters wide on each bank. Another study concluded that overall mammal species richness was conserved even in degraded forests, forests that otherwise might be thought to be too damaged already to be worth protecting. And yet another study found, unexpectedly, that there is no impact from land use changes on the biomass or number of fish in small streams, suggesting that these fish could be a sustainable food source for villages established in human-modified forests or in developed oil palm plantations. These are the types of results that SAFE wants to use to inform how palm oil is farmed, and in fact, how any fragmented landscape can be designed to best preserve the environment in the face of land use change. And once even more years of data have been collected, the SAFE project will inform relevant governments about the best land use policy. For example, at the moment, governmental guidelines on the amount of riparian reserves around rivers varies greatly. In Sabah, the law says that 20 meters of natural vegetation on either side of a riverbank has to be preserved. In Indonesia, it's 50 meters. In other parts of Malaysia, it's 5 meters. And other regions have different guidelines altogether. But as I mentioned before, some studies are already finding that maybe 100 meters or more are necessary to be sufficient wildlife quarters to preserve biodiversity. Results like these will be funneled to policymakers and members of the Roundtable for Sustainable Palm Oil to try to set up a system in which, despite some deforestation happening now, the rainforest can survive and rebound once the local economies move on to other forms of industry one day in the future. To really save the rainforest requires an unromantic, often tedious compromise between industry, ecology, and politics. None of it is easy, and with fairly rampant corruption in many of the countries in question undermining any progress made, it can feel like an impossible battle. It will take years of discussion from the decision makers, long hours spent in the field, and integrity from relevant politicians. But with all of these things working together, in theory, there is hope for a future world still covered in rainforests. The subject of deforestation is a massive one, and there are many, many things we need to understand in order to save the world's forests. Scientists everywhere are tirelessly gathering data and discovering the answers needed to inform conservation efforts. And while they are working to understand the rainforest, we can work to understand their efforts and the ecology that surrounds the problem by signing up to CuriosityStream. CuriosityStream has thousands of high-quality documentaries, including many about environmental and ecological subjects. You can learn more about the fascinating work being done to study the impact of forest fires in the Amazon, for example, in the documentary called Amazon Burning. It highlights the complex fieldwork being done there and explains some of the high-tech methods used for measuring carbon storage in tropical ecosystems. And because CuriosityStream also loves independent creators, an annual subscription to CuriosityStream now includes a subscription to Nebula, a streaming site created by a bunch of the best educational YouTube content creators like Tierzoo, Minute Physics, Wendover Productions, and our other channel, Real Engineering. Nebula is a place for videos to be watched ad-free and for creators to try new ideas without fear of demonetization on YouTube. The next Real Science video is already available on Nebula, which won't be on YouTube for another month. It's also building its library with loads of exclusive content, like Real Engineering's new Logistics of D-Day series coming out at the end of this month. So to get all that, along with access to CuriosityStream's library, sign up at curiositystream.com/realscience, and you'll get an email with a link to get your free Nebula subscription. Learning about a wide range of subjects, like the ones on CuriosityStream and Nebula, is one of the best things you can do to help the world in its environmental battles.